Hello, everyone.
My name is Chris Castro. I'm one of the directors of jazz combos here at UC Davis. I just wanted to thank you all for coming. We're all really excited to play for you. This first combo, the program's going to be in reverse order, so we're going to start with From This Moment On, and then On the Sunny Side of the Street. I just want to introduce the band now, just to save some time. We have Aaron Lowe on piano, Zach Davis on bass, Albert Stanley on drums, Miles Roach on trumpet, Juliana Mastro on alto, and Jerry Kuo also on alto. Thank you again.
Thank you.
How's everyone doing today? Yeah? Ready to hear some jazz? Well, you just heard some jazz. How about if a Chris Castro's combo? That'd be great. So this is our James Brown combo. By the way, those of you who don't know me, my name is Jacám Manricks. This is my fifth year teaching here in one capacity or another. Second year teaching combos and running the big bands. Speaking of which, I won't miss this opportunity to plug our big band concert, which is this coming Thursday night. It's going to be really great. Been preparing a lot of fun material as a chart, big band chart, of a Piazzolla song, Libertango, among Stevie Wonder material and other material by Benny Golson. And actually, we're gonna premiere a new piece that I've written too for the band. So that's Thursday night. And also there'll be the Snarky Puppy Ensemble opening for that concert too. So those of you who know of Snarky Puppy, wanna come check it out. We're playing a couple of numbers out the front of the big band concert this Thursday night at 7 p.m. right here. So come check that out if you can. But right now, we're gonna bring it back to the combo. And this is our fusion combo. So jazz fusion, jazz soul fusion, became popular in the late 60s and 70s. It's where jazz musicians melded styles from bands like James Brown and Sly and the Family Stone with jazz approaches, different jazz approaches that had happened up until that time. So we're going to play a piece by Aretha Franklin to kind of honor her. We lost her last August. Those of you who don't know her, you probably all know her, but she was an amazing woman, and not just as an artist, but also fighting for civil rights. I did this chart for the big band last quarter, and I believe we also did it for a combo, but not with these musicians. Dez here on vocals has always been saying, yeah, I really want to sing one, but we'd never been able to sing one. So I was like, well, I've got this vocal chart. And she said, well, I like singing R&B. And I'm like, okay, well, I've got an R&B vocal chart. So this is Think by Aretha Franklin. We hope you enjoy it.
Into that one, because that one's
thank you so much. So the last piece we're going to play for you, and not surprisingly, it was performed and kind of made famous first by James Brown and his band. It's called The Chicken, and it was written by a saxophonist, composer, arranger who worked with James Brown in the 60s, the mid to late 60s. His name was Pee Wee Ellis. He also worked as an arranger and a saxophone player with guys like artists like Van Morrison, and he actually studied with Sonny Rollins, the famous jazz saxophone player, and went to Manhattan School of Music. So this is The Chicken, and we also love this song because there's a really wonderful version of this song performed by Jaco Pastorius, who was a gentleman who was an electric bass player who kind of reinvented the role of the bass, of the electric bass. He was such a phenomenal virtuoso on the instrument. So we hope you enjoy this. This is our arrangement of The Chicken. Thank you.
James Brown Ensemble with the Bears, Christina, Ralph, Nick, Jason, Lena, Cliff, and Mario with the green glasses.
A little fusion for you. So we have our next ensemble hopefully coming out any second, and it's from one extreme to the other because this is quite a different style. This is going to be a tribute to the music of John Coltrane, and in particular almost a transitional period for him. As these guys are coming out and getting on stage, I will talk a little bit about Coltrane, and you can welcome them out first. Why not? Yeah. This is Derek Mitchell. This is Sam Hempelman on bass, Benjamin Green and Carpet, James. He'll be right back. So, where was I? John Coltrane. So I like to think of Coltrane as three main periods. The astounding thing about him, of course, is that he's an international megastar of jazz. Everybody knows the name John Coltrane. He's a household name. But yet his career was not really much over 10 years in the limelight. Initially, he came to the audience's attention in the band of Miles Davis. And when Miles was with the Prestige record label, and they made a bunch of records, four records, they were kind of in a hurry to make them in the end because Miles had another record contract with Columbia that he was trying to get to, so he wanted to fulfill his requirement with Prestige, and he recorded the four albums Working, Cooking, Steaming, and Relaxing. And so John Coltrane, the tenor saxophonist, was on those albums, and he played on those, and that helped everybody get to know him. And then toward the end of the 50s, after spending quite a bit of time with Thelonious Monk, there was a period there where a critic, Ira Gittler, coined Train's playing as sheets of sound, where he would cram every possible note and every possible arpeggio over every single chord. And that was when he was extremely fluid. So the Prestige years, if they were a little more melodic and simplistic and very pretty in Coltrane style, then the sheets of sound period at the end of the 50s was where he was really trying to stretch the envelope. He was really pushing the envelope. He was looking to get to the next level in terms of a virtuoso saxophonist and also just discovering new harmonic and melodic possibilities and really working them out. Now, the next period kind of pertains to what we're about to play for you, and that's, John Coltrane Classic Quartet happened in the beginning of the 60s, and then toward the middle and the end of the 60s, he died before the end of the 60s, but before his death, he was searching even more and getting more progressive as an improviser. A lot of his music from that period could fit into the free jazz subgenre, where there sometimes are not predetermined aspects in the music, like for instance a key or a tempo, where musicians would just get together and kind of, for want of a better word, jam, and just kind of get, when there were such profound musicians doing this, it led to some incredible recordings. I'm talking about recordings like Stellar Regions and this sort of thing. Now, in 1964, he recorded A Love Supreme, and we're going to play a piece from A Love Supreme. And A Love Supreme is kind of one of the more accessible examples of free jazz, and that's why I thought it'd be great to kind of work on it with these fine young musicians. And at the exact same time, in fact, Love Supreme was recorded in one session in December of 1964, and the other song we're going to play for you, called Wise One, was recorded in two sessions, one in April and one in June in 1964. And it's from an album called Crescent, which is another favorite album of mine. And so I think this is kind of like a transitional period for Coltrane, where he's starting to really stretch out and open up and get freer and freer in terms of where he's going and what he's searching for musically. So we hope you enjoy. The first song we're going to play for you is Wise One, and the second one is Resolution. I just like to say it's been this is Ben Green's last concert with me, and I've been doing concerts with him for 5 years. Give it up for Ben. Yeah, when I first started here and I was running the composer's workshop, he came and participated in that, and it was a lot of fun. And then he's been playing in the big bands. He'll also be playing with us on Thursday night. And Derek, are you graduating? And this is Derek Mitchell, also, who's graduating on the drums. Derek's a wonderful drummer, and he's played in a bunch of combos with me, I think every quarter, pretty much, since it started. Maybe you know you did John Paul's one time. Yeah, but it's been a real treat to have these guys. And, you know, I never would have thought when I first came here that we would get to music this advanced. And this is a very high level, this requires a very high level of musicianship to be able to play this music. So we hope you like it. Thank you.
Resolution from John Coltrane's A Love Supreme. This is Ben Green, Derek Mitchell, Sam Hempelman, Carl Kane. Thank you very much. John Coltrane Ensemble. So the next combo we have coming out for you is the bebop combo. And bebop was the first modern jazz. And it was, we're talking the mid-1940s or the beginning of the 1940s, and then it kind of became well known by the mid-1940s. Artists by the name of Dizzy Gillespie, Charlie Parker, Thelonious Monk, Bud Powell, these guys were the pioneers of the bebop subgenre of jazz. And it's when jazz came out of its most popular period, which was the swing era, you know, Benny Goodman and all those dance bands when everyone was dancing to the music, and started to get a lot more complex. Now, we're not actually playing any song by any of those pioneers of bebop that I mentioned, but we are playing a song with one of their, actually two of their nicknames in the title. It's called Bird, Bud, and Duke. I guess I should know the title since I wrote it, huh? Okay, so Bird, Bud, and Duke, and it's a song that's based on rhythm changes. And rhythm changes is an AABA form, song form, 32 bars long, and it's a typical framework or form for a lot of the compositions that were played in the bebop era. However, this is a little more kind of elaborate arrangement of it, but the melody also is kind of very similar to a Bud Powell song, or a typical kind of melody that Bud Powell, the pianist from the bebop era, would write. So we hope you enjoy it. This is called Bird, Bud, and Duke. Thank you.
Okay, this next piece is also a very advanced one, because this ensemble is actually one of the more advanced ones that I've had the pleasure of working with in my 5 years of working here. So I'll take a moment now to introduce them. This is James Merges on the alto saxophone, Ben Green on the tenor saxophone, Michael Gruenwald on the trombone, Lucas Weiser on the piano, Zoe Harrison on the bass, and Josh Zucker on the drums. So, and this piece is really quite difficult. It's in 7-4 for a start, but it's kind of a 7-8 groove, and but it's kind of a familiar framework in that it's kind of a 12-bar blues or an 11-bar blues, if you're counting in digits, more like 7. Anyway, it's complex, but it's still funky, and we hope you enjoy it. It's called Cluster Funk. Thank you. Thank you so much, the UC Davis Bebop and Castro combo. James Burgess, Benjamin Green, Michael Grunewald, Lucas Weiser, Zoe Harrison, and Josh Zucker. Hey. We're going to welcome out the last combo for this evening, also directed by Chris Castro. We hope you enjoyed it. I'll let him do any announcing or that he would like to do or not.
Hello. Thanks again, everyone, for coming. We're just going to end the show. As printed, I just want to introduce the band. We have two pianists. We have Kyle Chuang and Alex Lee on piano. Victoria Houston is our vocalist. Adrian Allah is on tenor. Katie Chu is on trombone. Andrew Saluna is on drums. Last time I played, my bass amp didn't work, so I just want to do that really quick. Thanks again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming.